Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description box, and they are also provided in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is about the precautions that are to be taken while looking at the sun during the upcoming annular solar eclipse. In the analysis of this news article, we will discuss about the concept of eclipse, solar eclipse, why precautions are required, and we will also see in brief about lunar eclipse. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. What do we mean by eclipse? See, an eclipse takes place when one celestial body moves into the shadow of another celestial body. So there are two types of eclipses on Earth. One is an eclipse of the moon and the other is an eclipse of the sun. Eclipse of the moon is called as lunar eclipse. An eclipse of the sun is called as solar eclipse. So what do we mean by solar eclipse? We know that moon moves in an orbit around Earth. At the same time, Earth is also orbiting around the sun. Sometimes when moon orbits Earth, it moves between the sun and the Earth. When this happens, the moon blocks the light of the sun from reaching Earth. So what will happen when moon blocks the light of the sun? Moon's shadow will fall onto the Earth. In other words, the moon casts a shadow onto the Earth. So this causes an eclipse of the sun, or it is also called as solar eclipse. Now why do we call it as solar eclipse? Because moon comes in between sun and the Earth. Sunlight is blocked. As a result, it is sun which disappears from the view, either completely or partly. According to NASA, solar eclipses happen once in every 18 months and they last for a few minutes. Now there are three types of solar eclipses. One is total solar eclipse, then the other is partial solar eclipse, and the third one, which is also discussed in the news article, called as annular solar eclipse. And a total solar eclipse is visible only from a small area on Earth. And the people who are seeing the total eclipse, they are in the center of the moon's shadow area. When moon's shadow hits the Earth, the sky will appear very dark and it will be as if it is night. And for a total eclipse to take place, the sun, moon and the Earth must be in a direct line. We are saying it as total solar eclipse because if someone observes sun from the center of moon's shadow area, the moon will be completely covering the sun. That is why it is called as total solar eclipse. Now let's come to the second type, called as partial solar eclipse. This happens when sun, moon and Earth are not exactly in a direct line, or when they are not exactly lined up. Here if you observe the sun, it appears to have a dark shadow partially. That is the reason why it is called as partial solar eclipse. The sun is blocked partially. The sun disappears partially. In total solar eclipse, sun disappears completely, particularly when it is viewed from the core shadow area. Now let's come to the third type, called as annular solar eclipse. Now here you should not confuse the term annular with annual. When we say annual, it means once in a year. But here it is annular solar eclipse. The term annular refers to ring shaped. If you see in this image, the annular solar eclipse, it appears to us as if there is a ring around the moon. That is the reason why it is called as annular solar eclipse. So this eclipse happens when the moon is far away from Earth, or when the moon is farthest from Earth. So what happens when moon is far away from Earth? It appears to be smaller. It seems smaller. And when it is farthest from Earth, it does not block the entire view of the sun. So that is why if you see this annular solar eclipse, you can see that the moon, which is in front of the sun, it looks like a dark disk. In the circumference, you can see the larger sun-colored disk. So this creates an image like, a ring around the moon. So that is the reason why it is called as annular. And this is also the reason why it is also called as ring of fire. meaning as if the ring which surrounds the dark disk is made of fire. Now let us understand two terms which are related to solar eclipses, umbra and penumbra. During a solar eclipse, moon casts its shadow on earth. There are two types of shadows, one is umbra and the other is penumbra. Umbra is the dark center of moon's shadow, and people standing in umbra, they will see a total eclipse. This umbra is what we called as core shadow area. When we say penumbra, it refers to the half shadow that occurs because in this case, sun is only partly covered by the moon. Umbra refers to the shadow area where the entire sunlight is blocked by the moon, whereas penumbra refers to the region around the umbra where the sunlight is not entirely blocked by the shadowing object here, which is moon. Now let us come to the news article. The news article states that the upcoming annular solar eclipse will be visible in some parts of Tamil Nadu. But the ophthalmologists, they have warned against viewing this rare phenomena through naked eye, and they have also warned against taking pictures using mobile phones or cameras. And doctors have also warned against viewing this ring-shaped solar eclipse through telescopes as well without sufficient protection. Now the reason is, sun is a large source of energy and it contains harmful ultraviolet radiations. And usually when we stare at the sun for a longer time period, our eyes get stressed. This is simply because sun releases more energy than the energy that can be handled by the naked eye. What happens during annular solar eclipse? We will be able to see the outer disk of sun like a ring around the blocking moon. The doctors are saying that this can damage the retina of our eyes. And this damage caused to the retina is called as retinal burns or eclipse blindness. And this can result into a significant loss of vision. They are saying that the concentrated solar rays will damage the retina of our eyes. This is because if someone observes the sun during this phenomena through a camera or a telescope or binoculars or any other optical devices other than eclipse glasses or handheld solar viewer, the mirrors in the camera, telescope, binoculars or any other optical device, they concentrate sun's light energy. And during this phenomena, these concentrated solar rays will damage the filter and it will enter the human eyes, causing serious injury. Now let us see few information with respect to lunar eclipse, then we'll wind up the analysis of this news article. So in solar eclipse, we saw that moon comes in between sun and the earth. The moon blocks the sun's light reaching the earth. Now in case of lunar eclipse, earth moves between the sun and the moon. Earth blocks the sun and therefore sunlight could not be reached to the moon. So sun appears normally, whereas moon's appearance is not normal. Therefore it is called as lunar eclipse. Normally what happens? Sunlight reaches the moon and moon reflects sunlight, and therefore it appears that moon is shining. Now during lunar eclipse, what happens? Instead of sunlight hitting the moon's surface, Earth's shadow falls onto the moon. And we can observe lunar eclipse from Earth during night by observing the moon. There are two types of lunar eclipses. One is total lunar eclipse and then partial lunar eclipse. A total lunar eclipse occurs when the moon and the sun are on exact opposite sides of Earth. Though the moon is in the shadow of the Earth, some sunlight reaches the moon, and when sunlight passes through Earth's atmosphere, that Earth's atmosphere will filter out most of the blue light. Or we can say those lights with lesser wavelength, they will be filtered out by Earth's atmosphere. As a result, red light, which has more wavelength, reaches the moon, and that is the reason why moon appears red to the people on Earth during a lunar eclipse. That is during a total lunar eclipse. Now let's see about partial lunar eclipse. So this happens when only a part of the moon enters the shadow of the Earth. During a partial eclipse, Earth's shadow appears very dark on the side of the moon that faces Earth. So what people see from Earth during a partial lunar eclipse depends on how the sun, Earth and moon are lined up. A lunar eclipse usually lasts for a few hours. it is said that at least 2 partial lunar eclipses can happen every year, but total lunar eclipses are a rare phenomenon. But it is mentioned that it is safe to look at a lunar eclipse. Now let's come to the safety with respect to solar eclipse. According to NASA, a total solar eclipse is safe. Human beings need no filter to observe a total solar eclipse. But other than total solar eclipse, human beings require filter while observing, because in a total solar eclipse, a sun will be as bright as the full moon only. So it is safe to look at it. But during all other time, during other solar eclipses, sun is dangerously bright, so it can be viewed only through special purpose safe solar filters so as to safeguard our eyes. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. We saw about eclipse, types of solar eclipses, we saw about umbra, penumbra, we saw about why we have to take careful precautions while observing the sun during annular solar eclipse. And we finally discussed few points with respect to lunar eclipse. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is with reference to the post of or the office of Chief of Defense Staff. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. The news article mentions that the Union Cabinet, which is chaired by the Prime Minister, has approved to create the post of Chief of Defence Staff. The creation of this post is a part of the reform in higher defence management in the country. It is expected that this reform in higher defence management will enable the armed forces to implement coordinated defence doctrines and coordinated defence procedures. And the reform will also help in fostering jointmanship among the three services, Army, Navy and Air Force. So here when we say joint manship, it refers to conducting integrated military operations with common strategy, common methodology and common conduct. A nation is said to have attained joint manship in its armed forces when it institutionalizes the joint planning, joint development of doctrine and joint policy making. By institutionalizing these procedures, the nation will be benefited because of coordinated action on greater joint manship in training, logistics and operations, and also greater joint manship for prioritization of procurements. Now let's see about the Chief of Defense Staff and the functions associated with this office. See, the Chief of Defense Staff or the CDS will be in the rank of a 4-star general. Generally, if you see, the Chief of Army Staff is a 4-star officer in the rank of a general who commands the Indian Army. If you see the Chief of Naval Staff, this officer is also a 4-star officer in the rank of Admiral and commands Indian Navy. Chief of Air Staff is a 4-star officer in the rank of Air Chief Marshal commanding Indian Air Force. So the chiefs of all the defense forces are 4-star officers. In the same way, Chief of Defense Staff will be in the rank of a 4-star general, and the salary and perquisites of CDS will be equivalent to a service chief, that is Chief of Army or Navy or Air Force. The CDS will head the Department of Military Affairs. This department is to be created within the Ministry of Defense, and this department will function as the secretary of CDS, that is, it will function as the secretariat of CDS. So what will be the areas that are to be dealt by Department of Military Affairs, which is headed by Chief of Defense Staff? Firstly, it will deal with the armed forces of the Union, which are Indian Army, Indian Navy and Indian Air Force. So these forces will be dealt by Department of Military Affairs of Ministry of Defense. Secondly, the integrated headquarters of Ministry of Defense, which has Army headquarters, Naval headquarters, Air headquarters and Defense Staff headquarters, this integrated headquarters will be dealt by Department of Military Affairs. Then the Territorial Army, this will also be dealt by Department of Military Affairs. So coming to genesis of Territorial Army in our country, we can trace the genesis to the First War of Indian Independence in the year 1857. At this time, a volunteer force was raised. And after this, in the year 1917, the Indian Defence Force Act was enacted. Under the Indian Defence Force Act, all universities, they were asked to provide contingents to the Defence Force. Indian Defence Force consisted of two branches. First, the European branch, which had the old volunteer force under the designation of auxiliary force. And the second branch is the Indian branch. This Indian branch later became part of Indian Territorial Force. The Territorial Force was constituted for service within the limits of Indian frontiers or Indian boundaries or borders. The Indian Territorial Force was aimed at forming a second line of defense to the regular army. And the Territorial Army in its present form, it came into being when the Territorial Army Act was enacted on August 18 of 1948. So this Territorial Army will also be dealt by the Department of Military Affairs, headed by Chief of Defence Staff. Then the works related to Army, Navy and Air Force will be carried out by Department of Military Affairs. And finally, those procurements that are exclusive to the services, except capital acquisitions, will also be done by Department of Military Affairs. Apart from various areas that are covered by Department of Military Affairs that we just discussed, the mandate of this department will also include areas like promoting jointness in procurement, jointness in training, and also in staffing of the services. Then the department will also promote use of indigenous equipment by the services. Now coming to CDS, other than being the head of Department of Military Affairs, the CDS will also be the permanent chairman of the Chiefs of Staff Committee. Now as permanent chairman of Chiefs of Staff Committee, the CDS will perform some important functions. One of them is administering tri-services organizations. And those tri-service agencies or organizations or commands that are related to cyber and space, these agencies will be under the command of the CDS. Then on all tri-services matters, the CDS will act as principal military advisor to the Union Minister of Defense. While CDS will act as principal military advisor, the three chiefs of services will continue to advise the Union Minister of Defense on those matters that exclusively concern their respective services. And CDS will be a member of Defense Acquisition Council and also a member of Defense Planning Committee. Now, this Defense Acquisition Council is a comprehensive structure or an overarching structure which was constituted under Defense Minister for the purpose of overall guidance of defense procurement planning process. Now, coming to Defense Planning Committee, this committee was constituted recently in 2018 as a permanent body. It has been set up under the chairmanship of National Security Advisor. Now, this Defense Planning Committee facilitates comprehensive and integrated planning for defense matters. It will also analyze and evaluate all relevant inputs relating to defense planning. And this committee will also put a roadmap for defense manufacturing ecosystem and also strategy to boost defense export. And other than the roles with respect to DAC and Defense Planning Committee, the CDS will also function as military advisor to the Nuclear Command Authority. Then as a follow-up of Integrated Capability Development Plan, the CDS will implement 5-year Defense Capital Acquisition Plan and 2-year roll-on annual acquisition plans. We'll see about these acquisition plans in some other day with respect to some other news article. Now know that these plans are to be implemented by Chief of Defense Staff. And CDS will also bring reforms in the functioning of three services with the purpose to augment the combat capabilities of the armed forces. This can be done by reducing wasteful expenditure. So these are some of the information with respect to the defense of the Chief of Defense Staff. We saw the various roles that are to be played by the CDS and also the various areas that are to be dealt by the new department to be created in the Ministry of Defense, for which the CDS is to be the head. The news article also mentions that the government has recently informed Parliament that CDS would come under the ambit of Right to Information Act of 2005. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next news article. This news article mentions the observations made by the International Monetary Fund. It has mentioned that India is now in the middle of a significant economic slowdown. In this context, we'll see briefly about IMF, functions of IMF, and IMF in comparison with World Bank Group, and we'll also see few important reasons for the economic slowdown that are mentioned in the news article. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See, International Monetary Fund and World Bank Group, they were founded at the Bretton Woods Conference in the year 1944. Therefore, they are collectively known as Bretton Woods Twin Institutions. This Bretton Woods is a remote village in New Hampshire in United States of America. So IMF and World Bank Group, they are twin intergovernmental pillars that support the structure of world's economic and financial order. The World Bank Group, it works with developing countries and poorest countries to reduce poverty and to increase shared prosperity. Whereas IMF's primary purpose is to ensure stability of the international monetary system. When we say international monetary system, it is the system of exchange rates and international payments that helps nations and their citizens to transact with each other. So how does IMF ensure the stability of international monetary system? So this it does by keeping track of global economy and the economies of its member countries, and it also provides and it also carries out money lending activities to countries that face balance of payment crisis, and it also gives practical help to members whenever required. And IMF works to strengthen global monetary cooperation, to secure financial stability, to facilitate international trade, to promote high employment and sustainable economic growth, and also to reduce poverty around the world. These statements are exactly from the official source of International Monetary Fund. So even IMF works to reduce poverty around the world. So here we can somehow arrive at some fundamental difference between World Bank and IMF, that World Bank is primarily a development institution. This is because it provides special financial assistance to those countries that are poorest developing countries through its International Development Association, and it also assists developing countries through long-term financing of development projects and programs. So World Bank primarily seeks to promote the economic development of world's poorer countries, whereas IMF oversees the international monetary system. IMF promotes exchange stability and orderly exchange relations among the member countries. And IMF supports its members, both industrial economies and developing economies, whenever they have temporary balance of payment crisis or difficulties. It provides some short-term credits or medium-term credits when they face such difficulties. So IMF is a cooperative institution that seeks to maintain an orderly system of payments and receipts between nations. Now, if you look at the reports that are published by both institutions, IMF publishes World Economic Outlook, Global Financial Stability Report. In case of World Bank, they publish World Development Report, Global Economic Prospects Report, Ease of Doing Business Report, and few other reports. So now coming to the news article, it mentions that India's current growth slowdown is mostly cyclical, not structural. Now here, when we say cyclical slowdown, it refers to the cycle of growth where there is economic boom, which is followed by economic downturn. Then by taking appropriate steps, there will be economic recovery, and then boom, then slowdown. It goes like that. So if you look at news article, it mentions that India's growth in the second quarter of financial year 2020, it has decreased to 4.5%, which is at a 6-year low. And if you see the composition of growth, it indicates that the private domestic demand has expanded only by 1% in the second quarter. Now, according to IMF, the present slowdown or the present economic situation in our country is attributed to the reduction in credit expansion by the non-banking financial companies. They are saying there is abrupt reduction in the credit expansion, and this is associated with tightening of credit conditions and also weak income growth. Tightening of credit conditions refers to the situation where non-banking financial companies or banks are not giving credit or not giving loans as demanded or as required, maybe because of various stresses like non-performing assets and other financial situations. When we say weak income growth, we are referring to particularly the weak rural income growth because there is severe drop in private consumption in the rural areas. And there is a drop in private investment as well because of financial sector difficulties, which include even public sector banks. So investment is required for growth, but drop in private investment hurts the growth sentiments. Now, other reasons for economic slowdown, we can say eroding business confidence. This we can say with respect to drop in demand or some of the policies of the government that impacts certain industries. For example, the policy to switch to BS6 standards by April 2020 has impacts with respect to automobile industry. And the policy to switch to electric mobility will also have impacts on automobile industry. And there are also other reasons with respect to non-stabilization of goods and services tax. When launched in July 1, 2017, it was thought that within a period of 1 year or 1.5 years, the tax structure will stabilize and government will be able to realize at least the projected revenues. We are seeing that the finance ministry is struggling to realize the tax revenue. In fact, it has struggled a lot to even compensate the states that have lost revenues as a result of implementation of GST. However, with respect to other metrics, the IMF has mentioned that India is doing well. Now, what are these metrics? For example, forex reserves. We have recently reached the record level of forex reserves. Then the narrowing current account deficit and manageable inflation rates. So these are some of the positives at present that IMF has noted that India is doing well. Finally, it has called for sound economic management so as to reverse the prolonged economic downturn. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next news article. This open editorial article is based on a notification released by the government of Karnataka on 20th November 2019 that allows women to work in night shifts. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this editorial article is given here for your reference. The notification has mentioned that the government of Karnataka is allowing employment of women workers in night shifts in all factories that are registered under the Factories Act 1948. Here the night shift mentioned is from 7 p.m. till 6 a.m. in the morning. This notification or this provision applies only to those women who come forward to work during the night shifts. So there is no compulsion here. Now this decision is based on a judgment delivered by Madras High Court in 2000 in the case law of Vasanta versus Union of India and others. In this judgment, the High Court of Madras struck down a particular section of Factories Act of 1948. This section is section 66(1)(b). This section was declared unconstitutional as it violated articles 14, 15 and 16 of Indian Constitution. So what is this section 66(1)(b) of Factories Act of 1948? So this section provided for provisions with respect to restriction on employment of women. Clause 1b of the section mentioned that no woman shall be required or no woman shall be allowed to work in any factory except between the hours 6 a.m. and 7 p.m. So this means that women were not allowed to work in factories between 7 p.m. and 6 a.m. by the Factories Act. In addition to this, the section also included a provision which mentioned that the state government by notification can vary the limits that are laid down in Clause B. But such a change effected by the state government shall not authorize the employment of any woman between the hours of 10 p.m. and 5 a.m. So this means whatever can be the new change that are to be made by the state government, women are not allowed to work in the time period from 10 p.m. till 5 a.m. with respect to factory or group or class of factories. So here we can say that this provision is clearly discriminatory to women and particularly violated articles 14, 15 and 16 of Indian Constitution, as the discrimination here is based on gender or according to Constitution, sex of an individual. Article 14 is about equality before law. It mentions that the state shall not deny to any person equality before the law or equal protection of laws within the territory of India. Now, we know that though we talk about Article 14, there is slight exceptions with respect to the office of President and the office of Governor based on Article 361 of Indian Constitution. Now, let's focus with respect to this issue mentioned in the editorial. So, coming to Article 15, it provides for prohibition of discrimination on grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. And Article 16 provides for equality of opportunity in matters of public employment. This article in Clause 2 clearly mentions that no citizen shall be ineligible for any employment or office under the state if the citizen is discriminated on grounds such as religion, race, caste, sex, descent, place of birth, or residence. Though this Article 16 deals with matters of public employment, here if you see the Factories Act, it is a legislation made by the state. So a legislation made by the state cannot be violative of Article 16 and cannot bring discrimination in the matters of employment on the basis of sex or gender. So that is why the Madras High Court held that provision, Section 66(1)(b) of the Factories Act 1948 is violative of Article 16 as well. So based on these constitutional provisions, the Madras High Court noted that it is clear that women cannot be excluded from employment during night shifts when they are being employed in the same factory during the day shifts. And the denial of employment on the sole ground of sex or gender is violative of Article 15 and it is discriminatory and therefore unconstitutional. The court further noted that it is imperative or it is necessary for the state to eliminate obstacles and to prohibit all gender-based discriminations as required or mandated by Articles 14 and 15 of Indian Constitution. So therefore, the Madras High Court struck down Section 66(1)(b) of Factories Act of 1948. The court has also made guidelines and welfare measures for the female workers who come forward to work during the night shifts. On a whole, we can say that these guidelines place the responsibility on employers to prevent sexual harassment in the workplace. And under these guidelines, it is the duty of employers to provide appropriate working conditions in the matters of work, leisure, health, and hygiene. So keeping all these factors in mind, the Karnataka state government has issued notification to allow employment of women workers in night shifts in all factories that are registered under the Factories Act. The notification has also listed out conditions on which the employment has to be provided. These conditions are in line with the guidelines provided by the Madras High Court that we have discussed with respect to the case law. So this is the background of the notification. So based on this notification, firstly, the authors note that some states already allow night shift for women in factories. These states, according to the authors, are Haryana, Rajasthan, Punjab, Andhra Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, and Maharashtra. Here you should note one point that Madras High Court judgment and the night shift provision extended by some of the states are in line with the Protocol of 1990 to the Night Work Women Convention of 1948 and the Night Work Convention of 1990 of the International Labour Organization. The protocol provides to remove sex or gender-based discrimination in night work and to remove restrictions to practice any profession, occupation, trade, or business of a person's choice. The convention, it provided for specific measures that are required by the night workers based on the nature of night work. So this is to protect health of workers, assist the workers to meet their family and social responsibilities, and also to provide opportunities for occupational advancement, and also to compensate them adequately and appropriately. And the measures and some measures has to be taken also in the fields of safety and maternity protection for all workers who are performing night work. Now, with respect to the ratification status of this protocol and the two conventions, we are unable to establish whether India has ratified the Night Work Women Convention of 1948 through the authentic sources, but know that India has ratified the Protocol of 1990 to the Night Work Convention of 1948, and India has not ratified the Night Work Convention of 1990 of ILO. Now, coming to the editorial discussion, see, according to the authors, the advantages or the positives of this night shift extension to women, one is that it will improve the increase of female work participation rate. It will benefit trade sector, it will also benefit manufacturing sectors, and then particularly, for example, if you take garment industry, in these industries we can find many women are employed. So when more people work in night shifts, including women, the entire industry will benefit as such, depending on other conditions in the economy. But there are several concerns with respect to the extension of night shift to women workers. The first concern is raised by women employees. See, according to the notification, the night shifts for women will only be allowed if the employer ensures adequate safeguards with respect to occupational safety and health and protection of dignity and honor and transportation from the factory premises to those points nearest to the workers' residence. These are welcome steps, these are right steps, these are required that will enable participation of women more and more in the work. But the problem is that, according to authors, these conditions, rules and regulations already exist for many years, but still women workers are unable to gain confidence to work at night because there is no safety, no dignity in workplace, even during daytime. So workers will be worried that how employers will ensure all these mentioned conditions, rules and regulations in the notification during the night shifts. The second concern is that Garment Labor Union of Karnataka, they have stated that they were not consulted with respect to the extension of night shifts. And they were also not given any circular for examination or perusal. So these concerns have not been heard or addressed before the publication of notification. Now, given they were all included in the process of making the notification or developing the notification, some concerns would have addressed. These people, they know the ground realities, and some protective provisions would have been incorporated. The next concern is that night shift extension notification does not address the issue of pay structure for night work. According to authors, they are saying that workers already have a complaint that they are not given the promised minimum wage for their work. So in this case, payment for night shift will be a big problem for women employees, particularly in factories. Now, the next concern is with respect to existing mechanisms for laborers that are aimed at addressing workplace violence, addressing abuse of workers' rights, addressing verbal abuse. Now, authors are saying that these mechanisms are dysfunctional because they are violated to meet the production targets. For example, if a woman leaves after mandated hours of work, say 9 hours, but the company wants her to work more during daytime, I'm saying, so the supervisor of this worker or employee will start scolding her, and at time it may result into verbal abuse, abuse of worker rights, and sometime it may lead to workplace violence also. But these provisions to address workplace violence, abuse of workers' rights are overlooked to meet the production targets. So what safety is there with respect to occupation, permanent provision of employment, we do not know. So when some of the new conditions are laid down by the notification with respect to handling workplace violence or abuse of workers' rights, there is a concern that will they be properly implemented or not. Now, the notification strengthens the role of inspector of factories who is responsible for doing examinations and inspections that are required in a factory. According to the notification, the employer has to send fortnightly report, that is once in 14 days. The report has to be sent to the inspector of factories about the details of employees who are engaged during night shifts, and the employer should also send an express report whenever there is some untoward or unexpected incident in night time. But according to the authors, the inspections are conducted improperly and the inspectors are negligent even with respect to grave violations in factories. So they are raising concern that even if such violation is reported, the employees will face the threat of losing their job. The next concern is with respect to CCTV cameras. The condition based on the notification is that employer has to provide proper lighting and CCTV footage inside the factory, surrounding the factory, and also to the places where female workers go. Here the concern is that there is no guarantee that the CCTV will be operational always, and there is no clarity on who handles the footage of CCTVs. Now you may think whether the notification says exactly like this. If you see point number 9 of the notification released by the Karnataka government, it mentions that the employer shall provide proper lighting and CCTV coverage not only inside the factory but also surrounding of the factory and to all places where the female workers may move out of necessity in course of such shift. Shift refers to night shift. So there is some concern with respect to this matter. Now the next concern is that the notification does not address child care. No creche facility in the factory has been mandated by the notification. So it will be difficult for the working mothers to take care of their children during the night shifts. In a way, it also becomes an obstacle for the working mothers. Next, the notification mandates for sufficient number of restrooms for women in the factories. Our concern raised is that at present, breaks are not frequent in factories due to high production targets. So both things are required. One is sufficient number of restrooms exclusively for women, and then sufficient number of breaks has to be operationalized. So finally, the authors conclude the editorial by saying that the brands and their managements have to be involved in the discussions with respect to worker dignity and equality, because it is these management, they place the demand based on which the production targets are fixed. And we saw during the article that the production targets lead to various kinds of abuse and violations with respect to worker dignity, workers' rights, and verbal abuse and equality. Secondly, in all such discussions, the workers and trade unions should be included so that appropriate concerns of the workers can be addressed with respect to extension of night shift. If you see in Constitution, Article 43A talks about participation of workers in management of industries. It mentions that the state shall take steps by suitable legislation or in any other way to secure the participation of workers in the management of undertakings, establishments, or other organizations engaged in any industry. So these are some of the concerns with respect to the recent notification released by the Karnataka government. We saw the points made by the Madras High Court with respect to the case law of Vasanta versus Union of India and others. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. Now this first question is with reference to Eclipse. They have given 3 statements and are asking to select the correct statements from the quotes given below. First statement, an eclipse of the sun happens when the moon comes in between sun and the earth. Now you read the term eclipse as obstruction. An obstruction of the sun happens when the moon comes in between the sun and the earth. Now this is true since the sunlight is blocked by the moon. We call it as solar eclipse. And since sun partly or completely disappears from the view on some parts of earth, we call it as solar eclipse. Now the first statement is correct. So once you know the first statement is correct, you can eliminate option B. Now come to the second statement. It mentions that an annular solar eclipse happens when the moon is nearest to the earth. Here we can replace the word annular as a ring-shaped solar eclipse happens when the moon is nearest to the earth. Now we know that annular eclipse happens when the moon is farthest from the earth. Only in such case, the moon will not block the entire view of the sun from the earth. So it will appear like the moon will be in front of the sun. It will look like a ring of fire surrounding the dark disk of moon, which is called as annular eclipse. So here the second statement is wrong. So when you finalize the second statement is wrong, you can eliminate options A and D. So you can easily arrive at the correct answer, option C, 1 and 3 only. Now come to the third statement. During a total lunar eclipse, the moon appears red. A total lunar eclipse occur when the moon and the sun are on exact opposite sides of Earth. In this case, though the moon is entirely obstructed by the Earth, somehow the moon receives some sunlight. When sunlight passes through Earth's atmosphere, the light with lesser wavelength are filtered out by Earth's atmosphere, and finally the red light, which has higher wavelength, reaches. That is the reason why moon appears red during a total lunar eclipse. So the third statement is correct. So the correct answer for this question is option C, 1 and 3 only. This question is with reference to World Bank. They have given two statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, World Bank assists all members, both industrial and developing countries, that find themselves in temporary balance of payments difficulties by providing short to medium term credits. Now, this statement is incorrect because it is the job of International Monetary Fund. It is the function of International Monetary Fund. So, once you find first statement is incorrect, you can eliminate option A and option C. Now, second statement, it acquires most of its financial resources by borrowing on the international bond market. Now, this statement is correct. Now, if you see International Monetary Fund, it draws its financial resources, or it receives its financial resources principally or mainly from the quota subscriptions of its member countries. Whereas World Bank acquires most of its financial resources by borrowing on the international bond market. So the second statement is correct. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Now, this question is with reference to International Monetary Fund. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, it oversees the international monetary system. Now, this statement is correct. The second statement, it promotes exchange stability and orderly exchange relations among its member countries. Now, this statement is also correct. So, you can eliminate option B and option C. Now, the third statement, it seeks to promote the economic development of world's poorer countries. Now, this statement is wrong because this is the fundamental objective of World Bank Group. So, the third statement is incorrect. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 and 2 only, because the first and second statement only are correct. Now, let us see a previously asked question with reference to a publication known as World Economic Outlook. Which of the following organizations brings out the publication known as World Economic Outlook? We know that the correct answer for this question is the International Monetary Fund. Along with the World Economic Outlook, the IMF also releases Global Financial Stability Report, Fiscal Monitor, and also External Sector Report. So the correct answer is option A, the International Monetary Fund. Now, this question is with reference to Ease of Doing Business Index. This is a question asked in UPSC Prelims 2016. India's ranking in the Ease of Doing Business Index is sometimes seen in the news. Which of the following has declared that ranking? So the correct answer for this question is option C, World Bank. In addition to Ease of Doing Business report, the World Bank also publishes World Development Report and Global Economic Prospects report. So the correct answer is option C, World Bank. If you see World Economic Forum, it releases Global Competitiveness report. And in case of World Trade Organization, it releases World Trade Statistical Review and also World Trade Report. Now let's move on to next question. Now this question is with reference to Chief of Defense Staff. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are incorrect. The first statement, CDS will head the Department of Military Affairs that is currently functioning under the Ministry of Defense. Now this statement is wrong because as of now, there is no Department of Military Affairs. It is yet to be created within the Ministry of Defense. So the first statement is incorrect. So you can eliminate option A and option B. Now coming to second statement, CDS will exercise military command over the services chiefs. Now this statement is incorrect because CDS will not exercise any military command. Why the CDS will not exercise military command over services chief? This is to ensure that the CDS will provide impartial advice to the political leadership. So once first and second statements are incorrect, We can easily eliminate option A, B, C. So the correct answer for this question is option D. All the above statements are incorrect. Now coming to third statement, CDS will be the principal military advisor to the Prime Minister. This is incorrect because CDS will be the principal military advisor to the Union Minister of Defense or Raksha Mantri. The CDS will be principal military advisor to Union Minister on all tri-services matters. So the correct answer for this question is option D. Now see this mains question. Women are being allowed to work night shifts in factories even as their concerns about daytime work persist. In the light of the above statement, discuss the legal backing and the concerns associated with women working in night shifts. Now for this question, with reference to legal backing, you can mention the Factories Act 1948, Section 66(1)(b), how it dictates with respect to night work for women. And you can also mention the case law wherein Madras High Court struck down the Section 66(1)(b), that is Vasanda versus Union of India and others. And then you can also highlight the recent notification by the Karnataka government with respect to provisions related to women working in night shifts in factories that are coming under Factories Act of 1948. And you can also mention the special provisions relating to employment of women that are mentioned in the Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code Bill of 2019. See, this bill has not yet become an enforceable legislation. And in this Code Bill of 2019, Section 43 mentions that appropriate government, let it be central government in its jurisdiction or state government, may prescribe various conditions relating to safety, holidays, working hours or any other conditions so that women workers may, with her consent, be employed in an establishment beyond 7 p.m. and before 6 a.m. So this Section 43 in the Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code Bill of 2019 deals with employment of women in night. So these provisions you can highlight in the legal backing. Then with respect to concerns, you can mention about having separate pay structure, measures or steps required with respect to tackling sexual and other kinds of harassment and abuse, violation of workers' rights, CCTVs and their operational and monitoring requirements, and ensuring safety of women while returning and coming to office or establishment, and ensuring Krisha facility for working mothers. Here the most suffered will be single mothers. You can raise concerns with respect to availability of restrooms, availability of leisure time such as having optimal break time during night working hours, and then maintenance of restrooms. And you can add various other concerns with respect to or associated with women working in night shifts. So these are some of the points you can mention in this question. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment and subscribe to Shankar AIS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We'll meet you tomorrow.